Hello all, I am Dr. Aisha Zanib, Associate Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology. This lecture is on moment of inertia, and it is a continuation of the previous lecture, which was just to refresh the centroidal portion that we had already discussed in the class. So what is moment of inertia? What's the concept? What do you mean by moment? Moment means the rotational effect of the force. And what is inertia? Inertia means the resistance to motion, right? So if you combine these two, we will be getting the concept of moment of inertia. So moment of inertia is nothing but the resistance to rotation if you consider a three-dimensional body with mass, which we call as mass moment of inertia. And if you are considering a two-dimensional body like a thin lamina, then the resistance of that lamina to bending, actually that rotation with respect to an axis, we can consider that as, instead of that, we will be considering that as bending, the resistance to getting deformed, right? This is known as area moment of inertia. So we have two typical inertia. One is mass moment of inertia and the other is area moment of inertia. So how will you define moment of inertia? Moment of inertia is the product of the area and square of the distance from the reference axis. So let us consider x and y as a reference axis and the distance small x and small y as the distance from the reference axis to the area dA. Then we can define the moment of inertia as Ixx, moment of inertia about the xx axis as integral y square dA. And moment of inertia about the yy axis, Iyy, as integral x square dA. Now, integral x dA is nothing but, if you remember the centroid, integral x dA divided by integral dA was how we defined centroid, right? So, centroid is nothing but the first moment of area. So, moment of the first moment of area, because x into x dA, x square dA. So, we also moment of inertia is also known as second moment of area, okay? Now, that is for an irregular shaped section. Now, if you are having composite section, that is sections with standard figures, we can simply add up the moment of inertia of each figure separately. So, we write it as summation y square dA as integral Ix, as Ixx and Iyo as summation x square dA. Now, the unit of moment of inertia is millimeter raised to 4 or meter raised to 4 in terms of SI. SI units, because y square is meter square and dA is again area which is in meter square. So it is meter raised to 4 or millimeter raised to 4. So we have to see some more terms. One is radius of gyration. Now radius of gyration is defined as the distance from the axis of reference where the whole mass or area of a body is assumed to be concentrated so as not to alter the moment of inertia about the given axis. Now we know Ixx is equal to summation y square dA or is equal to integral y square dA. Okay, so if you have this area with respect to this xx or yy axis, now we assume that this entire mass or this entire area is concentrated at a distance ky from the xx axis. Then we can say Ixx is equal to A into ky square. That is the moment of inertia about the whole area about xx axis. Ix axis will be equal to A into ky square. So basically it is an imaginary distance from the centroid at which the area of the cross section is imagined to be focused. Like it is imagined to be focused at a point so that we obtain the same moment of inertia, right? So this is mainly useful in comparing different shapes, how they behave, the different shapes behave, like how much it resists to buckling or compression along an axis. Like we can compare how much one is better with respect to the other, right? So how will you, from this we will be getting the radius of gyration ky as square root of Ixx by A, and kx similarly you can consider the other way around, parallel to the y axis, and you will be getting it as square root of Iyy by A. Now let us come to two important theorems that we will be using in calculating the moment of inertia of a given figure, right? One is parallel axis theorem. What it states is that if the moment of inertia of a plane area about an axis through its center of gravity, which we denote as Ig, which is equal to Ixx in this case, the moment of inertia of the area about an axis BC, which is parallel to the first, that is the parallel to the xx axis, and at a distance of h from the center of gravity is given by IBC is equal to IG plus AH square. So what it states is that if you have a figure whose moment of inertia about its centroid is known, then you can always find out the moment of inertia of the same figure with respect to any other axis which is parallel to the centroidal axis. Using this equation, IBC is equal to IG plus AH square. Similarly, we have another theorem which is called the perpendicular axis theorem. It states that the moment of inertia of a plane area about an axis perpendicular to the plane area and passing through its centroid is equal to the sum of the moment of inertia of the lamina about two mutually perpendicular axes passing through the centroid and in the plane of the area. In simple terms, what I can say is IZZ, which is the ZZ axis, is parallel to the plane in which the area A is lying. Okay, so yeah, I have shown an irregular shaped figure. X and Y axis are the two mutually perpendicular axes which is passing through the centroid of that figure. And X and Y, both these axes will lie on the plane of the figure. Which is the plane of the figure? The plane of the figure is this plane of the laptop or the plane of the sheet. Right? Now, Z is the perpendicular one which is pointing towards you. Okay, so Z is also passing through G. Okay, so it is very important that it is all the axes should pass through the centroid. Okay, so if you know IXX and IYY, which is passing through the centroid, then IZZ is nothing but IXX plus IYY. That is what perpendicular axis theorem states. So IXX is the moment of inertia about the centroidal XX axis, IYY is the moment of inertia about the centroidal YY axis, IZZ is the moment of inertia about the centroidal ZZ axis. And this IZZ is also known as polar moment of inertia. Now, these are the standard centroids of the standard sections that we saw in the previous lecture. I've just put that in this slide, this lecture also to refresh. So, you know all these values for rectangle, circle, semicircle, right angle triangle, quarter circle, isosceles triangle, semicircular arc and quarter circular arc. Now, moment of, similar to this, whatever we saw for centroid, similar to that, moment of inertia of standard sections are also given. So, you have to remember or have this in your minds in order to calculate the moment of inertia of any composite section. Okay. So, for the rectangle, we are talking about the centroidal moment of inertia. Moment of inertia about the centroidal axis for the standard figures. Okay. So, why are we talking about this? Because if you know the moment of inertia about the centroidal axis, we can always use parallaxis theorem or perpendicular axis theorem to get the moment of inertia about any other axis. Okay. So, for the rectangle, the moment of inertia along the x direction, xx axis, is given by bd cube by 12, and that of yy direction is given by db cube by 12. So, the easiest way to remember this is, if you take the xx axis, the xx axis cuts the dimension d, right? Cuts the dimension d perpendicularly. Okay, it touches the dimension d. So, d cube into b. Okay, and the yy axis, if you see this yy axis, it cuts this dimension b, right? So, b cube. Okay, so db cube by 12. So, whichever axis it is cutting, cube of that, b cube, db cube by 12, and for rectangle it is bd cube, so the xx axis it is bd cube by 12. Similarly, for the right angle triangle, you can see for the xx axis it is bh cube by 36. This denominator changes, it is 36 now, but you can see that the xx axis is cutting the dimension h, so h cube, okay, bh cube by 36. And for yy axis, it is cutting the dimension b, so it is hb cube by 36. Okay. Now, for a circle of radius r, it is having pi, the value is pi r raised to 4 by 4 along xx as well as yy, because it is one and the same. You turn the circle, you will be getting xx as yy, right? So, symmetric. So, just remember, it is easy to remember, r raised to 4 by 4 into pi. Semicircle. You have two axes, one is the axis of symmetry which is passing along the y direction, and the other is the xx axis which is parallel to the base. So the axis which is parallel to the base passing through the centroid, the value is 0.11 r raised to 4. And the axis along its symmetry, the value is pi r raised to 4 by 8. For a quarter circle of radius r, so similar, if you take the semicircle, I'm just coming back to the semicircle, you can see along the axis of symmetry, the value is pi r raised to 4 by 8, which is half of that of circle. Okay, circle is also having angle of axis of symmetry. There it is pi r raised to 4 by 4. Half of that is pi r raised to 4 by 8. So for a semicircle, along its axis of symmetry, you have pi r raised to 4 by 8. The other one you have to remember, it is 0.11 r raised to 4. But now when it comes to quarter circle, you can see that it is half of 0.11, which is 0.055, right? So for a quarter circle along both the axes, which is one and the same, it is 0.055 r raised to 4. For an isosceles triangle of sides B and H, you have one axis of symmetry, which is the YY axis. There it is HB cube by 48. Now B is the dimension which the Y axis is cutting. So B cube, HB cube by 48. And for along the X direction, it is BH cube by 36, similar to the right angle triangle. For a hollow rectangle, it is simply nothing but the difference of two rectangular areas, right? 1 by 12 capital BD cube minus 1 by 12 small BD cube. Just you have to deduct one area from the, one moment of inertia from the other. Similar for the hollow circle. So you have to remember all these equations, all these values, not equations, values, so that you will be able to do problems on moment of inertia. Now let us take one problem. The problem is to determine the moment of inertia of the shaded portion about the given axis. The axis is marked in yellow. The YY and XX axis is marked in yellow. So we will be using this equation, parallaxis theorem, that is IBZ is equal to IG plus A square, to solve this. Okay. So this is a question, right? So first I'll take the x directional axis. I'll call that as BC axis. Okay, the axis along its base. So we'll be using parallaxis theorem, which is IBC is equal to IG plus AH square. What is IG? Moment of inertia about the centroidal axis. So like centroid, determining centroid of the composite section, we'll also have some steps involved in determining the moment of inertia of the composite sections. Okay, so first thing is, again, we'll be dividing this into known standard figures. So which are the standard figures we have? One is an isosceles triangle, second is the rectangle, and third is the circle. Now the third figure has to be cut from the first and second figure combined to get the shaded portion. Now what I'll do is, I'll take that BC, okay, and I'll take each standard figure separately. That is, I'm taking isosceles triangle, rectangle, and semicircle. Please understand that I am not changing the location of these figures with respect to BC. It is at that same height. Okay. Now I have to apply parallaxis theorem. So what will I do? I will be trying to get an axis which is passing through the centroid of these centered figures and parallel to BC. That is this G1, G2 and G3, and these three axes which is parallel to BC. Okay. So now this is the same figure. I've just removed that original question from the slide so that we'll get enough space to do the calculations. That is all. Okay. So let us take the first figure, the isosceles triangle. That is the case one, right? So what is the moment of inertia about this axis that we have drawn? You recollect whatever was there in the table. So we had it as BH cube by 36, right? So what is H here? It is 12. And B is 20. So what will be the value? 20 into 12 cube divided by 36, which you will get as 960. Okay. So that is your IG1, right? Moment of inertia about the centroidal axis of the first figure. Now for the rectangle, it is BD cube by 12. So it becomes 20 into 30 cube by 12, which is 45,000. Okay. And for the circle, it is pi r raised to 4 by 4. So now the radius is 5, so it becomes pi into 5 raised to 4 by 4, which is 490.8. So these are the centroidal moment of inertia about the axis parallel to the required axis, the parallel to the axis which is asked in the question, which is BC, right? So how will you get the moment of inertia about the required axis? You can always use the parallax theorem. IBC is equal to summation of IG plus AH square. That means you have to find out the moment of inertia of each figure about this BC and then add it up or deduct it. In the case of circle, you have to deduct because you have to cut the circular portion to get the shaded portion, right? So IBC1 is equal to IG1 plus A1H1 square, IBC2 is equal to IG2 plus A2H2 square, and IBC3 is equal to IG3 plus A3H3 square. So first let us take IBC1. So we know what is IG1. We got it as 960. You know the area A1 is half base into altitude. And what is H1? H1 is the distance between the two axes, right? The axis, the centroidal axis and the axis BC. What is that value? From the BC to the base, it is 30, right? Now from 30 to the from the base to the centroidal axis, it is H by 3, the centroidal distance, right? 12 by 3. So the total is 30 plus 12 by 3 is your H1, okay? Now what is H2? H2 is for the rectangle. Rectangle, the centroidal axis is at a distance of 15 centimeters from the base. So what is H2? H2 is 15. And what about H3? H3 is again 20. It is also directly given in the question, okay? So with this we can calculate IBC1, IBC2 and IBC3. So IBC1 is IG1, which is 960 plus half into 20 into 12, which is the area of the isosceles triangle, into H1 is 34 square. Don't forget to put the square, H1 square. Just don't put it as H1. It is H1 square. Otherwise, your answers will get wrong. Okay. Similarly, you find out IBC2, IBC3, and these are the three values. Now, what is IBC? IBC is equal to IBC1 plus IBC2 minus IBC3, because you have to deduct the moment of inertia of the circular portion and you will get it as 287,773.3 centimeter raised to 4. Don't forget to put the units. Now we find out the moment of inertia about the axis DE. Okay, that's a vertical axis. So what will we do? Again, we will number the figures. We will take each figure separately. And then we will try to mark the moment of the centroidal axis, which is parallel to DE, that is G1, G2 and G3. Now, if you check this, where will you mark DE? DE will be passing through G1, G2 and G3, right? So, this axis coincides with the centroidal axis, right? So, what is it? BD cube by 12 is 12 into 20 cube by 48, which is 2000. Here it is 30 into 20 cube by 12, which is 20,000, and it is pi r raised to 4 by 4, which is 490.8. So what is IDE1, IDE2 and IDE3? You can calculate that. But now in this case, H1, H2 and H3, both are, all the three are 0. So IBC is nothing but IG1 plus IG2 minus IG3. Or you can get it as 21509.2 centimeter raised to 4. Now let us find out one more moment of inertia about another axis GF, which is to the side of the same figure. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll fix the numbers. We'll fix the take each area separately, okay? So again we'll say G1, G2 and G3, then we'll mark EGF, okay? And then we have HBQ by 48 as BDQ by 12, I mean 12 into 20 cube by 48, which is 2000, the other is 20,000, the other is 490.8. These things we found out initially also. Now the axis is GF, right? So you have to locate GF. So once you locate GF, this is how it looks like, and now we need to use the parallax theorem wherein we need H1, H2 and H3. Now in this case, what is H1 for the first figure? H1 for the first figure will be equal to 10, right? From the apex, from the rightmost end of the isosceles triangle to the symmetric axis, right? G1, that is 10. for H2 will also be equal to 10 and H3 will also be equal to 10, right? So H1 is equal to H2 is equal to H3 is equal to 10. So which is so IFG is equal to IG1 plus IG2 minus IG3. That is, you will be getting it as 85655.2 centimeter raised to 4. So these are some questions for you to solve. Okay, the answers are also given so that you can check out your answers while doing the problems. So do this and see whether you are able to do the moment of inertia concept properly.